symbols for red, yellow, and green. It's, you know, what I do with my extra time. What this is actually, it's kind of a game. And what you have to do is you have to take out three balls, clear two, that on there, and what you have to do is take the empty, clear two, put in start, and try to get it in the same order. So I'll start off green, right? Start with the green. Then you get the yellow one, and finally the red one, right? So it's green, yellow, red, so it's green, yellow. Hang on. This happens sometimes, okay, I'll cheat a little, and what I'm gonna do, so I'll just put this back on there, and what I'll do is I'll cheat a little. Start with the green, right? So nothing. Cheat a little bit, you know, that's okay. Green. So yellow one. Then the red. So green, yellow, red. Hang on. Okay. I'll try this one more time, and then I'm giving up. Now I'm really gonna cheat. Okay? Got the green one and the yellow. Green, yellow. Good. Now, hang on. There was something in the book this came with, talked about if trick does not work, use Joker Box. And it came with, well, Joker Box. And as you see, I guess I'll just, wait a minute. Green, yellow, green.
What do you think, folks? Have you enjoyed it so far?
Yeah.
Okay, we're going to have about 15 and 20 minutes if you'd like to stretch, walk around, and we'll have some refreshments arriving momentarily. There's probably some young people here who are looking at this and thinking, well, maybe I'll try that at some time, and maybe they should consider it. I mentioned earlier the benefit of gaining self-confidence from this, and it really is something that really helps them. Speaking to someone earlier, they said their son had performed this in front of family members, but never in front of a group, and you would never know it to see them up here. One thing I'd like to share with you, and we have some small presenters here. A number of years ago, I spent a lot of time on platforms around North America, and when I was getting into this business, a friend of mine found out where I was going to be, and he was a great one with practical jokes. So the first time I went out in public to speak, and I got to my feet, and as you can see, I'm not very tall, I'll show you this. This is as big as I got. And I just got going into my remarks, and from the back of the hall came this voice that, "Why don't you stand out when you're speaking?" And the whole audience laughed, and I laughed, and I thought it was funny. And it was the first time, but the second and the third, it wasn't as funny. And it seemed that wherever I went, there he was at the back, and there was good old Vic saying, "Why don't you stand up when you're speaking?" And I got to the stage where I'd go into some place, and I'd look around, I'd get in there, and look under the lectern, and around here, and under the tablecloth, and he wasn't there, then I'd start to speak, and say, "Why don't you stand up when you're speaking?" Then somebody bought me a book on being politically correct, and using politically correct language. And I read in there, and I heard someone say that, "Brian, you are not short, you are vertically challenged." And I thought, boy, does this ever sound good? And I couldn't wait to get home. I went home and said, "Dear, you'll never guess, I am not short anymore." And she kind of eyes me up and down, you know, like, "Well, you look short to me." "I am not short anymore, I am vertically challenged." He says, "Yes, you're also horizontally enhanced, too." So as a presenter, you face these things, and it's learning how to roll with them, as you will discover our younger people will do as they get older. Let me share another story with you. I go out as a professional speaker, doing motivational talks and humorous talks, and I can remember one time I was asked to speak to a group of people that had just received their Canadian citizenship papers. And they were a proud bunch. They'd come from all over the globe. And they had a party plan. And what they were wearing was the costumes of their grandfathers, their great-grandfathers, grandmothers. In other words, their ethnic costumes. And they were a colorful group. People from Austria with the lederhosen and the short pants and the, you know, the alpine hat with a shaving brush on the side. And from the Orient, we had these people in these bright and beautiful kimonos. And as I spoke for about 20 minutes, and they seemed to like what I said. And then a lady came on the platform. And this lady was from northern China. And she was a very tiny lady. Maybe that big. In fact, she was the only lady that looked up to me for a long time, and I felt pretty good about that. And she was very slim, and she must have been 70 or 80, really old, but she had a smile that would melt hardened steel. And she'd been selected to come on the platform and thank me. And she did have this bright red dress on, and all these golden dragons, just looked beautiful. And I don't know if you know, but English is probably the toughest language to learn as a second language, of all the languages. Really difficult. And she came on the platform nervous, like some of our young people are, and she came on with a bunch of flowers, about 6 roses. Now, I'd never had flowers before, and that made me grow about 2 inches right there. Hey, I'm getting flowers from a lady. And she came on the stage and gave me this beautiful smile and said, "Mr. Taylor, I want to thank you on behalf of the group for your message." I said, "Well, you're most welcome." Then that beautiful smile disappeared, and I saw this look of panic. And I knew what had happened. She'd forgotten the rest. And she looked at the audience, and I could see she was getting ready to flee off the stage. And they were up on chairs saying, "Come on, mate, you can do it, you can do it." They're all yelling and screaming. She got the courage, turned back to me and said something. Now, I think the first part was in English, and then the second one sounded like a Confucius phrase. She said, "Mr. Taylor, these flowers may die, but you will smell forever." And you learn to roll with it. And what you learn is, how you learn is when you're on your feet in front of an audience. So we're ready to begin the second part of our program now. And to start off, it's a young man called Michael Van Der Zand. Michael is 12 years old. He's the son of the current president of Ring 66, which is our magic group. And Rob Van Der Zand, his father, is one of our instructors too. Michael has been involved with the junior club for about 3 years now. Besides magic, he plays right wing for an ice hockey team who have named him Crackshot. So he's going to be performing right on target, an amazing card revelation effect. So would you please give a warm welcome to Michael Van Der Zand. Michael, please.
Okay, when I time to stop.
Okay, that's good.
I'm not that good a shot.
Now kneel down so everybody can see. Okay.
Everybody duck.
And on the count of three, I would like you to aim at the balloon. Now, have you ever used a gun before?
Not very often.
Have you ever used a gun before?
I think you'll be okay if you stand over there.
I'll trust you. And I'll hold this stand just so it doesn't fall over. 1, 2, 3.
Oh!
Thank you, Michael. I think we have something in the audience that should be called Crackshot. How about that? Our next performer is Kevin Demoscott. Kevin is 13. He's a three-year student with the Calgary 66 Magic Group. And he's done something before. He's performed several public shows. He's graduating up the ladder to the more public arena. Besides magic, he also likes riding motorbikes. This afternoon, he will also perform the Chinese linking rings that we saw a little earlier, so would you give a warm welcome to Kevin Demoscott.
How you guys all doing today?
Great!
Okay, that's good. My name is Kevin Demoscott, as you just heard, and I'm doing the linking rings.
Okay. Need a drinking back here. There's two mechanics back here now.
I would have turned and run. I was waiting for the music, it didn't show, I would have been through the door and halfway over to the airport. Just hang on, and that's great. That's part of what this is all about, getting the stage presence to be able to stay there and wait for it to happen when it's all planned, and he did an excellent job. I didn't do a particularly good job of pronouncing his name. I said Demoscott, is Demoscott? How do you pronounce that? Demoscott. Leon Cooper is our next presenter. Leon is 11 years old, and he's been a member of the junior club for 2 years now. He found out about the club when he saw a magician performance at an event, and he was attending. So this same magician that he saw later became his magic teacher, his instructor in the group. Leon loves football, and he really likes tackling the quad bar, which ties into all the karate people we have here. Today he's going to tackle a trick called card walk. So would you give a warm welcome to Liam Cook, please? Now, in case you think this is an all-male domain, we had a young lady on earlier on, and now we have a second one. And this is very pleasing to see young girls getting involved in magic. Next member is Jen Kerr. Jen's 11 years old, and she has been with the Junior Magic Club for 3 years. Now, Jen is the granddaughter of Les Brocklesby, and he was the one who got her interested in magic, and so she comes by it through her genes. As you'll find out, Les has been involved in magic for many, many years. And they've been together on shows, working together on several occasions. Now her future, her aspirations for the future, she either wants to become an actress or a vet. Now they're not similar at all, but she's kind of deciding in between. And in the meantime, she's going to keep doing magic until she has made up her mind. Jen also has an interest in baseball, and she's a pitcher. So she's going to be pitching a couple of things at you pretty soon. She's going to present two tricks that she thinks are home run. One is called Metaphora Spots, and the other is Holly Parrot. So let's welcome Jen on the platform here. Jen.
Silk.
much do you think Holly is planning on doing?
Coming up now is a young man who's not a member of this club, but he said he's going to be joining in September when he has the opportunity to. In the meantime, he's been taking some individual lessons with the gentleman who's the territorial vice president of this group, and his name is Everett Andrews, who is a professional magician. We actually have some professionals in, as well as short people here. We like the idea of allowing him to come and join in and perform today, and he was all willing to do this. So Patrick is 15 years old, he enjoys baseball, soccer, and he has an artistic streak. He is an artist. He's going to show us a rope routine today, so would you please bring on stage